John Arthur Robeson, in his book Proofs of Conspiracy, wrote the following. Blah, blah, blah. And schisms in the Christian church, I saw that the Jesuits had several times interfered in it. The Order of Loyola, I believe that has to do with the Priory of Sion, was suppressed but helped to maintain their influence through the help of Freemasonry. Now, what's interesting about his book, I really want to finish reading this, is it was published in the same time, a few years after the Illuminati was formed, in 1776. This was published, I think, in 1789. So they're saying that a conspiracy against the church and government was going on since the foundation of the Illuminati. Interesting, no?
Over 200 years ago, in 1797, one of the most respected scientists in the world wrote a book entitled Proofs of a Conspiracy. He was John T. Robeson, Secretary General to Scotland's prestigious Royal Society and Professor of Natural Philosophy at the University of Edinburgh. What he detected while on sabbatical in Europe was a new element in the Grand Orient Masonic Lodges. He was approached by Adam Wei I. Short, the founder of this new elite, inviting him to join an inner circle known as Illuminism. Adam Wei I. Short was a professor of canon law at the University of Ingolstadt. He started the Order of the Illuminati on May 1, 1776, originally calling it the Order of Perfectibilists. His plan was to use the Grand Orient Lodges of Europe as a filtering mechanism through which to screen out talent and build a hierarchy of inner circles. Like the mafia of today, only the inner circle could be trusted with the true purpose of the Order. According to the Encyclopedia of Freemasonry, its professed object was, by the mutual assistance of its members, to attain the highest possible degree of morality and virtue, and to lay the foundation for the reformation of the world by the association of good men to oppose the progress of moral evil. Behind the benevolent appearing objective, the true purpose of the Illuminati, according to Robeson, was world hegemony. A world order ruled by an elite pretending to represent the common man, an elite who had penetrated every aspect of society from the arts to politics and law while shaping public opinion with more subtlety than the average citizen was able to detect. The Illuminati was presumed to have been dispersed by the end of the century, but some people such as David Icke, Ryan Burke and Morgan Gricar have argued that the Bavarian Illuminati survived and believe that Illuminati members chose instead to conceal themselves and their plans within the cloak of Freemasonry, under which auspices they continue to thrive. They have maintained a stranglehold on the political, financial and social administration of the United States and other nations, acting as a shadowy power behind the throne, controlling world affairs through present-day governments and corporations. The Illuminist plan was to unseat the present powers of hereditary aristocracy and replace them with an intellectual aristocracy, using a staged revolt of the masses. This, indeed, was exactly what the French Revolution appeared to be, key people in the Bavarian Illuminati catalyzing great numbers of people. The French Revolution was not a historical accident happening by whim, but was manipulated by geniuses who had their own agenda. Many believe the Illuminati are the masterminds behind events that will lead to the establishment of such a new world order, and see connections between the Illuminati, Freemasonry, the Trilateral Commission, British Imperialism, International Zionism, and Communism that all lead back to a bid for world domination. In more recent years, the Illuminati has allegedly been involved in the assassination of John F. Kennedy and has been at the forefront of indoctrinating the American public into their socialist one-world agenda. It is difficult to uncover the facts regarding the modern-day role of the Illuminati, as most of the information is cloaked in secrecy. What we must do instead is to look at the available evidence.
Now, the Bavarian Illuminati were ordered to disband after a courier carrying secret Illuminati doctrines was struck dead by lightning. Was it an act of God? Perhaps. Did Weishaupt carry out his influence by infiltrating the lodges of Freemasonry in the newly founded 13 colonies? That's also a theory, because, you know, maybe our founding fathers weren't in cahoots, and they just simply were infiltrated by the supposedly illuminated ones. Did George Washington worship the devil and Lucifer and have Aleister Crowley-style sex magic rituals? I don't know. Like I said, all I know is Washington was a highly prominent Freemason, and he definitely did a lot of stuff according to astrology and things of that sort, so... Here's something I wanted to show you in Time Magazine, their special on secret societies. We're going to skip to page 16 and 17. And it's, here's George Washington laying the cornerstone in the Freemason ritual. So you can see that we're not making this stuff up, you know. Here's where they're talking about Washington and Franklin guiding Voltaire through the mysteries.
Washington wrote in 1798, quote, "It was not my intention to doubt that the doctrines of the Illuminati had not spread in the United States. On the contrary, no one is more truly satisfied of this fact than I am."
Now, this magazine is really interesting. The only problem is, at the very end, they go into a whole spiel about how great Dan Brown's novels were about the Mona Lisa and whatnot. The All-Seeing Eye, adapted from Egyptian mythology. And that's where they're talking about the New World Order.
The New World Order.
And what about other secret societies?
They still exist, the Skull and Bones. And we've had several presidents that were members.
You were both in Skull and Bones, the secret society. It's so secret we can't talk about it. What does that mean for America? The conspiracy theorists are going to go,
"Oh, sure they are. I don't know. I didn't see the
red number 322.
First of all, he's not the nominee, but I look forward
to the prevalence.
And I'm not going to lose. And I'm not going to lose. And I'm not going to lose."
The members of Skull and Bones, a secret society of Yale. What does that tell us?
Not much, because it's a secret. Is there a secret handshake? Is there a secret code?
I wish there were something secret I could manifest.
322, a secret number?
There are all kinds of secrets, Tim, but one thing is not a secret. I disagree with this president's direction that he's taking the country. We can do a better job, and I intend to do it.
And we'll be watching the Safe on the Campaign Trail. John Kerry, thanks for joining us, and we'll be right back.
Skulls and skeletons are not only a tribute to celebrating death culture in society. They are also a salutation to the secret society established in 1832 at Yale University, which is called the Skull and Bones. Skull and Bones consists of all elite male members, and every year they recruit 50 new members. They meet in a place that has been nicknamed the Tomb, which is next to Yale campus. Their initiation rituals are satanic. The initiate first declares their worship to Eulogia, the pagan goddess of eloquence. The initiate is then escorted into the inner temple, which is called Room 322, to sign his name to an oath of secrecy. The initiate is then brought before a picture of Judas Iscariot.
I wanna love you, but something's pulling me away from you. Jesus is my virtue, and Judas is the demon I cling to. Judas is...
name, the group screams three times, and then he is led to the heart of the rite, where the initiate is pushed to his knees before a human skull filled with blood placed at the foot of the human skeleton. The initiate is made to drink the blood. This perhaps sounds far-fetched on first hearing it, but in fact they boast of their sick practices in plain sight. Look at Kesha on stage in front of her fans. This is not a random crazy pop star act. She is, like others, a puppet for the elite. Again, they revel to hide in plain sight what is really going on behind secret doors. The agenda of the Skull and Bones Society is simple: to create a new world order that restricts individual freedoms and places ultimate power solely in the hands of a small cult of wealthy, prominent families. This is a photo of the group. It is believed that the skull and bones on the table belong to the famous Apache Indian Geronimo. Prescott Bush bragged about digging up his grave with five other bonesmen and stealing his skull and femur bones. Notice also this chap on the far left. He has one hand hidden in his coat. This is a secret Masonic hand sign that many famous and influential men have posed for in photos and portraits. What does this mean? Simply put, all of these men who have contributed massively into shaping our history and today's culture are Masonic.
To your attention before we move on to the United States properly. Over the previous two parts, I posted three photographs that all had something in common. I didn't draw your attention to it, but you may have noticed it, even if subconsciously. Possibly having noticed it, you thought it was just a coincidence and didn't pay it any further attention. Take a look at these three photographs again. They were the ones of Karl Marx, George Washington, and Marquis de Lafayette. If you missed it, here they are again, side by side. Look at what they're all doing with their right hand. Now, why are they all hiding their hand like that? What does this hidden hand gesture mean? Does it mean anything at all? Perhaps it's just coincidence. Well, let's take a look at some more portraits of famous personalities from history. It happens far too often to be coincidence. This hiding of the hand gesture is actually from the 13th degree of Freemasonry, which is also known as the Royal Arch degree. It is symbolized with the triple Tau. Now, this gesture is the sign of the master of the second veil. I won't go into the details of it, but basically what this gesture is doing is signaling to other initiates that they're part of the secret brotherhood and that their actions are inspired by Masonic beliefs. What they're saying is, it doesn't matter what I appear to be on the surface, this secret gesture tells you that we are working towards the same utopian end, you and I. We are both enlightened with the illuminating knowledge of Masonry. Remember in the Jesuits' oath, they talked about being on opposing sides in public, but secretly were working towards the same end. That's why we have both communists and capitalists making the same gesture here. Think also of the Hegelian principle, where two seemingly opposing ideologies are rubbed up against one another to create a synthesis. What these famous leaders are saying to the initiated is that there is a hidden force or hidden hand guiding the course of history and that they are a part of it. It's that hidden hand that we've been following throughout the whole of this series, so it should come as no surprise to us by now that Satan is still at work in the world. These illuminated ones think Lucifer is good and following him will help mankind, but as Christians we know differently. We know that Satan disguises himself as an angel of light and always has. We'll look more at gestures later. With this in mind, we should be careful not to pledge too much allegiance or get too fervent about either side in politics. There was a situation in the 2004 presidential elections where Americans had to choose between John Kerry and George Bush. What most didn't know was that although one was Republican and one was a Democrat on the surface, both were members of the Skull and Bones Masonic Society at Yale University. Both being Freemasons, did the American public really have a choice at the polling office, or were they voting for the same ideals dressed in different colors? There's a reason why, no matter who we elect, things always deteriorate in politics.
Secret Society was originally called the Brotherhood of Death. George Bush Jr., his father George H.W. Bush, and his grandfather Prescott Bush have all been initiated into this macabre fraternity, which was established in 1832 at Yale University by William Huntington Russell. His family were America's biggest opium smugglers. William Huntington Russell had traveled in Germany during his student years and was befriended by a disciple of Adam Weishaupt's Bavarian Illuminati. Upon returning to the USA in the early 1800s, Russell used some of his family's opium wealth
to fund the building of the tomb at Yale University.